Welcome. My name's Roy Magnuson, and on behalf of St. Paul Strong, a collection of mostly well-meaning, mostly well-intentioned, mostly well-thinking people, we welcome you to my village. And to open our meeting, Yusuf M. Jenny.
As Roy mentioned, my name is Yusuf M. Jenny. He and I are both members of the steering committee of St. Paul Strong. And can I get the other steering committee members to raise their hand for the folks in the audience? Okay, so that you know who we are if you have any questions or if you want to pop somebody before you leave tonight. I'd also like to welcome Dai Tao, First Ward City Council member who's just joining us. You're seated right next to Jane Prince, and to her right is Dan Bostrom, another member of the City Council. Kudos to them for coming out and joining us this evening. We invited all of the City Council members. Four of them accepted. Three of them will be present with us this evening, and Roy will speak to that in a moment at the formal beginning of our program. How many of you are familiar with the work of St. Paul Strong? A fair number? How many of you, this is your first introduction or opportunity? There are a few. Then perhaps it might be appropriate for me to, most importantly, tell you what we are not. We are not a partisan group. We are nonpartisan, nonprofit. We're a community-based coalition of individuals. We did not endorse any political candidates. We asked candidates to endorse the six principles of St. Paul Strong, which were on the registration table. Did everyone have an opportunity to get one? If not, if you raise your hands, we'd be happy to see that you get one if you'd like. Everybody who, one gentleman here. Thank you, sir. You want me to take this or set it down there? We are not a special interest group. As individuals, we have special interests, but we are concerned about transparency and openness in city government by elected officials. The bulk of the city council candidates endorsed our six principles, as did many of the school board candidates. And STRONG is, of course, an acronym for those six principles that are spelled out in full on the information sheets that we had for you. Someone said we were militants, so I even went so far as to look it up in the dictionary, and you'll be pleased to know that Webster says a militant is someone who is firm in their beliefs and convictions. So if the shoe fits, I guess we have to wear it. The newspapers have referred to us as activists. We don't think of ourselves that way. We're very active and civically engaged, thank you. Several of us are retired. Some are in the business community. Some are in labor. We are black, white, red, brown, yellow, native-born, foreign-born. We're a diverse group geographically in terms of our interests. And about a year ago, a small group of people began meeting in coffee shops around the city that were concerned about a perceived lack of public input into the public dialogue and the public policy process. And gradually, as word spread, as ideas spread, the group coalesced around the notion, the biggest room in the world is room for improvement. And we simply want to see, if not facilitate, greater transparency and openness in government. Okay, the best public policies are the most well-informed. And we've seen examples of late, very clearly, of what kind of difference public input can make. The notion of parking meters on main thoroughfares throughout the city received a lot of public dialogue, some of it after the fact. There's been a lot of public dialogue around tax exemption for the soccer stadium. We saw public dialogue this week around the preservation of homes and commercial establishments in the Dayton's Bluff Historic Preservation Neighborhood. There are a number of examples. And we feel that when issues are publicized, communicated, discussed, and people have the opportunity for good dialogue, good communication, good input, that we wind up with win-win public policies that are mutually beneficial for all of us. We realize that downtown is everybody's neighborhood sometime, but there are 17 different planning districts, many smaller self-defined neighborhoods and collections of residents and business associations throughout the city. And we believe that it is important, with the changing demographics, with the critical issues that face our citizenry, that the residents of the city of St. Paul be included in that process. So tonight, as part of Inauguration Week activities, we have invited our elected representatives to join us and discuss some of these principles. Let me repeat that what we are is a process-oriented organization. We're not interested, we have not taken a position on bike lanes or any of the many other issues that face our city and our elected officials. We are interested in process. So as we pursue this dialogue this evening, you will have an opportunity to participate in that process by submitting process-oriented questions. And to further define and explain that process, let me turn the microphone back over to Roy Magnuson.
I don't know if I'll succeed, but a couple of things. We are, for I think the first time perhaps in the history of the city of St. Paul, operating under an enforcement of the closed meeting law / open meeting law, where city council is not supposed to have any meetings that has a public tend to it if there are more than three members. And as I was trying to figure out how the spirit of the law fit to having a meeting, there was a wonderful comment that we are having a public meeting that was publicly advertised in the newspaper and in a bunch of places, and we're actually meeting in a public house. And some people are having adult beverages, so you can't get much more public than that. And I'm not going to make an editorial comment about why, in the first time in the 150-plus years of the city of St. Paul, we have decided that not being able to attend with four council members is tonight, but it is. And newly elected Ward 2 council member Rebecca Naker has a statement that she wants to read because she volunteered to be the odd person out. And she wants everyone to know how sorry she is that she can't join us. She is so aligned with our mission, open, transparent, public process. She sees us as an example of what St. Paul Strong is working on and will be following up with us when she learns what's our next steps. So that's where we're sitting. And now our process for tonight, we'll have a bit of a discussion, and we'll have council members take the mic. We'll have some of our St. Paul Strong people talk. And then, as Yusuf said, we're going to be passing out some cards, and that's where we're going to be looking at. So right off the get-go here, let's just throw a question to the council members. In the idea of open and transparency, what is your position on the process of the city hall and the deleting of emails after 6 months?
Well, I'm new to the council as of Tuesday when I was sworn in, and this is something that I did take a position on during my campaign. Part of it is that I'm an attorney. I became an attorney at age 50, so I haven't been an attorney for a really long time. But I am a great believer in public access to information. Don Gemberling is in the room. He wrote the State Data Practices Act. And I really believe that eliminating emails after 6 months is removing a portion of the public record that is not only important for citizens to have access to, But there are bound to be times when a city staff person or elected official has something in the public record that's more than 6 months old that would be something that that person would want to demonstrate that they had fulfilled something, or they had made a statement, or they had tried to correct a misconception that no longer will exist for them to be able to prove that. That being said, and for those of you in St. Paul Strong who know how strongly I feel about this, I don't want to sound as though I'm making excuses. I did talk today with the city clerk, and the city, I guess, is actually being quite inundated with data practices requests that have made them feel that they need to alter the way they handle this kind of thing. So that's something that I will be looking at as I continue to serve in this position.
If I can interject for a second, there's no reason that everybody has to comment on everything. So if you say, I think it's covered, we don't have to run all through. And if one of the board members wants the mic, go ahead too.
Roy, we're going to hand out cards for people to write on. Do you want to do that?
After a couple questions.
Okay.
St. Paul has a strong mayoral system with only 7 council members who represent the vast diversity of St. Paul residents, businesses, and property owners. What are some tools you can use to ensure open and transparent public process in decision-making at City Hall?
Before I answer that, I just want to go back to the data practice. So I think that with the 6 month, we are in alignment with the state. Now, I'm not saying that that is the right way or the wrong way, but my background is IT. And so I deal with data all the time, and it's quite expensive. And we're talking about every day, I get about over 100 emails, and some of them are important, some of them are not, some of them are spam, some of them are still for my predecessor, Councilmember Melvin Carter III. And so it's trying to balance the competing needs of the city, right? Like, where can we cut resources so that we can have resources to plow, or so that we have resources so that we can have our police officer in the community to work with communities of color and kids of color so that we build rapport in the community. So those of you are just example of different competing interests and competing needs for the city. And so I thought that it was good for us to there were places that needed to be cut so that we can have more resources to do things, and that was my logic with the IT background. And so with Roy, with your about transparency and accountability, I like to say that government only work if there's transparency and there's accountability and there's openness. The deal that you made with us as elected is that you put your trust in us to do our work the best of our ability to in the best of your interest. But we are, and the way I've been, my experience is that it's like you are all my family members. And but yet you all have different interests, and I'm supposed to make everybody happy. And it's very difficult, and that's something that you don't learn in a textbook. You go through that, you experience that. But in the spirit of transparency and accountability and openness, I want to work with St. Paul Strong, and I think when we implement accountability and openness, it has to be across all the departments. It can't just be, for example, the council office or in the mayor's office. It has to be in the fire, the police, DSI, public work. It has to, because all of us supposed to be working for you. We can't pick and choose where we want accountability. And right now, in our during this time in our community and our society, police accountability, transparency is extremely important. And I hope that as we put forth, we can continue to work together to find what agree upon what is transparency, what's openness across all departments.
Could the panel members please identify themselves before they speak?
That was Councilmember Dietau. I'll stand because some of the folks couldn't see me.
Thank you.
for active participation and full access to our city government, is there a mechanism for constituents to address the council when their ward council representative says no? In the past, the council seems to have followed the protocol of respecting the wishes of the council person who has said no.
I'll take a shot at it. I'm Dan Bostrom. It's the good news and the bad news when it comes to that particular. Do you support the council member from the ward, or you try to take a citywide view? And I think you have to try and do both. If you as a council member do not aggressively support your ward, I will guarantee you nobody else will. So you have to be out there and actively and aggressively doing what you think is the right thing to get done in your particular ward. I look back, you know, I go back in this area a long, long time. I remember when I used to work up on Selby Avenue at Dale and Selby, at an office at 632 Selby was the police community relations office. Selby Avenue had really started a decline. And by the mid-70s, it was in serious, serious trouble. And by the early 80s, it was really, really tough. And things didn't really start to change around there until Bill Wilson, who was the council member for that ward, really put his shoulder to the wheel. And when you see what has happened on Selby Avenue, and it didn't happen overnight, but he worked hard day and night on that particular area, and he got his council colleagues to support him on that. And ultimately, we've got a beautiful street on Selby Avenue over there. But it's those kinds of things. Somebody has to pay attention. Back in the days when the council was elected at large, I think you could put your finger down at about Lexington and Grand, for example, and draw a circle out about a mile circumference around that. And probably most of the council members would have lived right in that circle. There were a couple of exceptions. Vic Tedesco was over on the east side. But other than that, it was really, everything was pretty much located in that general area. And that's where the mayors all came from, too. So now it is really spread around the city, but it's important for council members to understand that there are other neighborhoods that need help, too. And so you try to work with one another to get some of these important projects done. And it becomes a whole concept of relationships, of dealing with your council colleagues, and the ability to trust them. If they tell you they're going to support something, they will support you when the chips are down, and you will support them if you told them they were going to do that when the chips are down. Sometimes you have to take tough decisions, and you have to be able to count to four if you're going to get anything done. I remember there used to be a council member many, many years ago who would say, well, if you can get to four, I'll be your fifth vote. And it wasn't Ruby Hunt. but it is relationships and understanding and having a view of the entire city. There are a lot of city things going on, and downtown gets an awful lot of attention. But you know, you take it, to me, the important streets have been, and I'll start with my east side over there, with White Bear Avenue, with Payne Avenue, Arcade Street, East 7th Street, and then you've got Rice Street and Dale Street, and you got East 7th Street, and you've got West 7th Street, you've got the West Side, you've got Selby Avenue. You got these commercial streets that if they don't look good, that hurts the rest of the neighborhood, because those are the gateways. And I am a firm believer in that those neighborhood community thoroughfares have to look good, and that's where the resources really have to start. So when people visit those neighborhoods, they say, you know what, this looks pretty nice. I'd like to live here. I'd like to do business here. Or if it's in really tough shape, they'll drive right on through. I'll quit in just a second, but I have to give you one example. There was a fellow that approached me a few years ago, and he had been looking for housing in Minneapolis and Highland Park. And all the houses that he saw and he liked, they were in the $450,000, $500,000 range. And after looking at a bunch of them, he said, I can't afford that. Told his realtor to forget about it. About 2 weeks or 2 months later, the realtor called him and said, hey, I got a deal for you. You might want to take a look at this. So they got in the realtor's car and they took a drive out and they looked at a place over on Earl Street and Orange over on the east side near Lake Phelan. And it was about $225,000, half of what the Highland house was going for. And he said, it's exactly the same house. After looking at it three or four times, they decided to buy it. And after they moved in, and it was a few weeks later, he decided, you know, there's got to be a better way to get here from my job out there in Midway. The realtor had taken him out 35. They got off at Wheelock Parkway, drove Wheelock Parkway, went up and around and through, through the park. Those of you that are familiar with the neighborhood know what I'm talking about. And he found a new way. He said, I could take Maryland and I could go right straight up there. To which he said, if that realtor had taken me up Maryland at that particular time, by the time we got to Arcade Street, I would have told him to turn around. And that, you know, I thought I was onto something, but boy, that was something that really drove it home, that you, those neighborhood commercial streets have to look good. And that's been something that I've been struggling with for a long time, and we're making some progress over there too.
Member Top. I just want to, so, you know, that might be referred to as ward presidents. And so I think I want to give an example of something that Councilmember Bostrom and I voted against when Councilmember Thune, Councilmember Bostrom, remember the condo on Grand Avenue that was like almost a $2 million investment? And you and I, along with Chief Finney, right, the three of us voted against that. And so in favor of the appeal so that they can build a condo there on Grand Avenue. And then another one, I'm just gonna use you as another example because I know you'll forgive me. Just recently, like People's Inc., when they wanted to have a facility on White Bear, and I know that it was a really tough decision for Councilmember Bostrom, and we were advocated really hard by the neighborhood, but eventually we voted in favor of having the mental health facility on White Bear Avenue. And so, I mean, these are just some example of us voting on our conscience and what we believe is best for the city, especially for those that, like I said, least among us. And so I think I agree that there's certain vote that you, especially the legislative stuff, you know, usually you have to, if it impacts that ward, usually you follow the leadership of the council member. But if it's going to impact the entire city and quality of life, you know, you gotta, make your own decision. And so I think we have practiced some of that as well.
Ed, have you got the question cards? Ed and Andy are passing out cards for you to fill out. And what we'd like, and David too, we'd like you to try and focus on questions that reflect the principles of St. Paul Strong and are more on transparency, openness, effective government, and not necessarily a specific issue. And we are, I promised all of the council members I talked to that our goal tonight was to be a gathering of friends, not to play gotcha. So that's the piece. And then when you have a question, we'll be gathering them. So while we're doing that, I'll move to the next question. St. Paul's economy is driven by local independent businesses that provide goods and services and create jobs for our residents. Small business owners and entrepreneurs face daunting hurdles in order to understand and meet compliance standards for our city. What can be done to make the process of starting and or maintaining a local indie business more open, more transparent, and more accessible?
Well, I can speak to that, I think. I am on the, for a number of years, I've been on the board of the Metro Independent Business Alliance, which is made up of about 300 and some locally owned independent businesses in the Twin Cities. And we have been looking at what some of those hurdles are for our members. Linda Windsor and I are on the Public Policy Committee of that group. One thing that you just saw over, I can give an example in Minneapolis, is that Minneapolis was just putting forward a working family agenda that would have required 28-day scheduling for businesses. It would have required 5 days of sick and safe leave, and it was moving toward a $15 an hour minimum wage. I feel very strongly, I'm really supportive of those initiatives, and I believe that there are some ways in which we can look at those things at the city level, and more appropriately, even at the state level. I would love to have St. Paul explore those issues. But what Minneapolis discovered, in a mistake that I don't think we'll make in St. Paul, is that they moved forward and set a date for passing those ordinances by the end of the year. They had virtually no public process for businesses of any size, whether it was the Chamber, whether it was Metro Independent Business Alliance, whether it was just reaching out to a small group of businesses to say, what are you thinking about this? And just like Grand Avenue parking meters, when you tell businesses what's going to be good for them, instead of engaging them in how could this be done to work for you, what are your ideas about it? I mean, one thing that we know about those ordinances, they have been done in other cities, but they've applied to businesses over a certain size. In any case, I could kind of go on and on about that. I think what we've learned is that locally owned independent businesses are they really know what they're about. They're independent people who are very entrepreneurial. They have a lot of ideas, and they need to be part of processes that affect them. So I think that we just have to do a better job of working with business to determine what they need. The city has a business review council. It's aimed at trying to cut some red tape. I'm not sure that it's working really well. We do know that there continue to be a lot of issues for businesses, and I know that both Di and Dan share my concern about that we do need to find a way to make it easier to do business in St. Paul. So, but I think the first way is we have to really listen to our business community about their needs, what kind of red tape they need cut. If we think parking meters are going to be good for Grand Avenue, maybe we need to talk to Grand Avenue about where those parking meters should be, how they should work, and how they would work for those businesses. So I'll let it go at that.
Anybody else want to respond?
I feel like I'm saying a lot, but I have a lot that I've been wanting to say. In my experience, I think that as far as small businesses, local businesses, in terms of PED and DSI, I really believe that we need to diversify the workforce there. I strongly believe, as a person of color, that if I have a inspector who is a person of color who understand my community, who understand that instead of coming to meet with me, and I'm not saying that all inspectors are like this, but you come in, have a conversation with me, and help me how I could fix it, right? Not here to condemn me or punish me, but here to help guide me and say, this is the next step, this is what you need to do, this is the department that after you're done here, this is who you talk to. Right? Have a real conversation, a customer service, and investing in our business, a small business. I think that needs to happen. I also think that we need to have regular courses, whether it's online or out in the community, in the library, on the steps, on the chart, the flow chart, that if this is your first interaction, this is you go here, if yes, go here, no, go here, these are the people that you need to talk to. And with that said, my office is open. Whether you're in my ward or you're not in my ward, if you know anybody or you yourself want to start a business, call my office. I'll meet with you. I'll listen to your plan. I'll help you figure out a strategy, connect you with a person that you need to connect with so that you can have the same access to the grant, the loan, to help you build your business. With that said, I think the city also, the administration needs to put more money back into the neighborhood program, Neighborhood Star. These are some of the local, these are dollars that are put invested back into the neighborhood. A lot of this money has been taken away and has not been replenished, and I think we need to do that. I think we also need to do a better job of looking back and auditing our zoning and just through the book, right? If a certain code doesn't work anymore, doesn't apply, we need to change that. Even a child knows how to crawl, they know how to walk, and they become an adult. Society is the same. A city is the same. We have to change and adapt to the current needs, and we have to be innovative and flexible and respond to the needs of the market if we want to thrive, just like our sister city of Minneapolis, and you know, to really look at our city as a region, because we'll be competing against like Chicago, Milwaukee, Denver, all these sources. And so I think it's small business is important, and these are some of the things I think that can be done. And I'd like to also hear more, like what Councilmember Prince said, we also want to hear from you on how we can better serve you and cut these red tape for you as well.
Sam, do you want to respond to that question about small businesses?
Yeah, sure. Okay. Now, Yusuf raised a point. Questions can be addressed to both the St. Paul Strong Steering, and a couple of them were on here. And then Ed reminded me that all of the questions that we turn in, our plan is we will put them on our website and give council members a chance to put an answer there, because what we're trying to do is make a different channel of communication. So we're going to be a little bit responsive, hopefully, on that. Kasim.
My name is Kasim. I'm the education director of Minnesota Dawa Institute, which is a couple of blocks from here. And I live one block from here, too. So Frogtown resident. And that town is my councilman, and I'm glad that he talked about this. This is home for us as a new community, as a new immigrant community to the city itself and to the state. There's been a lot of issues with people who have lived here for the last 20 years to save up money, to buy businesses, to start up businesses, and they don't know the process. I'm going to use one example of a person who bought a building a block from here. She wanted to start up her own candle company, and she bought the building. The city asked her to change the roof. She changed the roof, and the building was condemned after she did that. Her building was demolished, and she has to pay for the demolishing of her building. So if she knew the process and how it worked, all of this wouldn't have happened. And I'm glad Daitao brought this up to address these things into the council and also to the city and across boards, every department, like he said, to get more reasonable ways to get the new immigrant families and people who've been here for 20 years, who want to start a business, who want to buy houses, and then they see their dreams shattered in front of them.
This is a both question, and it's, I think, a very good one. Where do the district councils fit into your vision for St. Paul?
I've had a lot of experience with them. Actually, I was the chair of the District 2 Community Council shortly after it was formed in 1976. And I served in that position until I was elected to the school board in 1980. So I had a rich history of working with it right from the time that those things were originally created. And a lot of them had some bumpy roads along the way and some false starts, and some of them had several false starts. But I think this has really matured now recently, and I find the district councils, at least the ones that I deal with, to be extremely responsible, that take a hard look at the zoning issues, licensing issues, and make some very good recommendations as to what they would like to see happen in that neighborhood, and also have plans and ideas about libraries and parking and playgrounds and schools. And so there's any number of issues that they've dealt with, and I have had just an excellent relationship with them, and I respect them. And I think there's a mutual respect because they know I listen to them. And they, again, like a lot of other things, they don't always get everything they want, but they know that they've had a fair hearing. I'd just also like to just take a moment, if I may, and recognize my County Commissioner, Jim McDonough, who's out there. This is another part of being in this business where you've got to have partners that you can work with. And Jim McDonough has been just a great one for us. I saw Sheldon Johnson around here somewhere. Tim Mahoney was here too. I don't know, Tim is around here somewhere. And those are some of the East Side elected officials that have just done a great job. I want to thank Tom Diamond too for the time that he served on the St. Paul City Council. And Andy is back there. And just all of the rest of the folks, Ruby, who have spent time in these chairs. It's a big job, and it's important. And the experience sometimes takes you a while to get it. And you can learn from those people that are on the community councils, and occasionally get somebody on there that's a little anxious to get started. And sometimes the folks have to settle them down a little bit and say, you know, you aren't going to do this overnight, but if we are responsible and we've got a good, steady track record, the city council will listen to you. And it's that responsibility that's so important. I'm sorry.
I'm John Manillo. I just wanted to say that St. Paul Strong is going to reach out to the community councils to offer to be a voice for them when they need it with the process. And so we've been pretty effective in getting our word out through the media. We've only been actively doing this now for, 3 months maybe, and have had an impact. So we want to continue to do that. And on our website, if people have questions, to ask it right on the website, and we'll answer it, and we will get the word out to the media and show any answers from the city council as well. So I hope that the city council embraces us as a way to communicate to the public. And so that's what our function is. We're not here to, I'm disappointed that three of our council people decided not to come. But in spite of that, we're not out to get anyone. We're trying to make our government run smoother. So that's what we're doing.
Thank you, John. When I don't have a lot of experience yet as an elected official, but I did work for 10 years for Jay Beninov when he was the fourth ward council person. And Jay's style of operating, which I hope to emulate, was that when an issue was coming forward in his ward in a particular neighborhood, whether it was a development project, the expansion of a university, or any number of things of that type, his first call was to the district council to say, I just learned about this, this is coming online, think about a process, think about, you know, what kind of meetings you want to have. Secondly, when developers came in to meet with Jay, the first thing he said to them was, the worst thing you can do is surprise the community, is surprise the neighbors where you're planning to build this thing. So I recommend that you get out to the district council, that you involve them as early as you can so that the ultimate project that you develop reflects, at least neighbors have had a chance to give you their input. You have an opportunity to figure out how much opposition you're going to get from the community and whether you can work some of those details out as you're developing the project. About my district councils, I can take no credit for this, but I really need to brag about District 4 right now. There are always issues in district councils, but we had our election in December for the district council board, and there were contested races in each and every sub-district. Any of you who know about district councils know that it comes down to often begging people to serve on the council, to put their name in for an election, and if they and two of their neighbors vote for them, then they're on. What happened with our contested races in District 4 was that people like Pachua Vang, who, Pachua? Pachua was elected. She, I believe you got 180 votes. I mean, this is, they, people had lawn signs. They canvassed their neighbors. And the most amazing outcome of all is we probably have the most diverse group of people who have ever been elected to a district council ever in St. Paul. It's just the most amazing, thank you, Di. It is the most amazing thing. Quentin Codger Kidd is in the back of the room. He was elected, and Pachua, I'm not sure if any of our other members, but I have great confidence in the work that citizens can do when they get together. I could really go on this topic, but I also want to say that District 1, which is the Battle Creek, Highwood, and Eastview neighborhoods, and District 4, which is Dayton's Bluff and Dayton's Bluff, is that it? East 7th, yeah, why exactly. Those two neighborhood groups have really focused on equity, on involving our diverse communities, on trying to draw both renters as well as homeowners into the process. And something that District 1 did, and many of you may have participated in it, was they put together community dialogues that were held during October and November on police, on parks, and I think the other one was neighborhoods, I think. But in any case, they involved city staff, neighbors, citywide neighbors. I mean, every people came from all over, but they were put together by District 1 and have really revealed some great material on to guide the city as we go forward in those areas, and so that we don't have the Fergusons happening here. So in any case, I have tremendous confidence in our council.
Just quickly, it's a really important subject with the district council. Ward 1 has probably, geographically, we have the most district council that's connected to our ward. I believe there's five of them. And so what we do is we have regular meetings where I invite the leadership from the different district council. So last year, what we did through these process, we identified that trash was one of the big issue that everybody wants to work on. And so I find money and resource so that they can work on that. One of the things that we did was out of that whole process, we also found that the district council from across the city wanted to have a central database so that they can track the constituents, complaint, or members, or issue, so that we can have these data. So based on these data, it would make my job easier and my fellow council members' job easier when we advocate and fight for resources with the administration. And so I think that all district council, I'll be honest, right? Highland District Council is going to be different than the Frogtown District Council 7. And so we still need to work harder to diversify. And I clap because I think that diversity on the district council board is extremely important because it represents the people, the voices, and that's what makes government work. And that's why I was really acknowledged and excited about your presentation.
I'm going to jump in. I'm Linda Windsor. I'm on the steering committee of St. Paul Strong. And as far as process goes, I served on the Summit Hill Association District Council for years, and I follow it, and I'm on a subcommittee now. For process, it's great to have district councils and have all these things that have been talked about. But for example, when you go and you make a recommendation to the BZA, the Board of Zoning Appeals, and they vote it down continually what the district council has come forward for, the only way to go forward in this process at the city is for the district council to cough up $400 for an appeal to go before the city council. To me, I think it would be something to look at, that why are the district councils going through the work of making a recommendation? You can't always get what you want, but if you look at the pattern, there are a lot of times when their recommendation is turned down. Where's the accountability on that? And then why are the neighborhoods being charged to come before the city council? And it gets back to the first one of the first questions that was read. If if I have an issue in my neighborhood and my council member says I can't address the city council, and I represent probably a bunch of neighbors, that can stop the public process for us to be able to raise issues at the city council level. So I think that's what we're trying to get at with these questions and with this forum, is how can we open up this process and make it easier for the community to be involved in what's going on at City Hall. Thank you.
Okay. Well, my name is Patricia Vang, and I am newly elect at the Dames Bluff District Council. So I'm very honored to be here and also to be a part of St. Paul Strong. But one of the things that I also wanted to include and let everybody know is that with this new district council, I'm very happy that 50% of the district council is of people of color that are representing the community. When we come together as a community, we are actually stronger. We are inclusion, there is transparency, and there's accountability and equity among all of us. What may work for your district may not work for mine, but I'm open to all district council, what their inputs are and what works for their district. I'm also in favor of working with all council members from all of the different wards, but not only that, but with also the county commissioner and the House representative as well. But as somebody who is newly on the district council, I will look forward to their guidance and to their leadership. But I want to make sure that transparency is a very, very big issue. And I hope that with this, this is a process where the community is really involved.
I'm Ruby Hunt, and I was on the city council in the 1970s. And I also was... Okay, and I was also involved in getting a new charter for St. Paul, which went into effect in 1972. In the old charter, there was a provision that at the end of every city council meeting, the public was invited to come up and speak to the city council. And when the new charter was adopted, I can't remember exactly what happened to that provision, but gradually over the years, the opportunity to appear personally at a city council meeting sort of faded into the background. I remember at one time when a woman from Frogtown, who was an activist in that neighborhood, she came to the city council meetings on a fairly regular basis and had something to say about Frogtown. And she always got attention because she had a hat made in the form of a frog. So I think that that kind of personal relationship that people were able to establish was very healthy. At times, it probably has to have some kind of a regulation so that it doesn't get out of hand from people that sometimes want to talk too much. But anyway, I think the citizens would like to have an opportunity where they could have a personal appearance before the city council.
I'd like to see the hat for Cathedral Hill. I'll keep my day job. Save Our St. Paul Neighborhoods is working to involve neighborhood residents in neighborhood housing decisions. How can you help this effort?
I have been involved and I have joined Save Our St. Paul Neighborhoods. So you probably want to hear more from my colleagues, but one thing that Save Our St. Paul Neighborhoods weighed in on was the Dayton's Bluff properties that were before the council last night for demolition. The HPC had turned the city down on their demolition permits, and the city was appealed. The HPC turned it down on the basis that they felt that there were some additional options that could be considered to preserve the homes. And the city appealed that decision to the city council. And again, I think there was a very strong feeling on the part of the Dayton's Bluff District Council and members of the historic district group who felt that there had been virtually no discussion with the community about those houses. And if you take four houses down in a small area of a historic district, you're definitely changing the character of the community. So what I did, and I think any of us would have done the same thing, is I asked the city in the PED department, the department head and staff who were involved in this, and the neighbors. I asked the city attorney if I could get everybody together to work out, to see if there was an opportunity for a compromise. And for reasons having to do with it being an appeal, I myself could not take a position on the appeal. So the city attorney gave me the go-ahead, and we all met on Tuesday, and the most amazing thing happened, which was I simply said, "You're all here. Could you talk about this and see if there's anywhere to get? I can't take a position. I can't tell you what to decide. I can only kind of facilitate the discussion." And it was really wondrous to see that in about a little over an hour, everyone had decided to take 6 additional months, do another request for proposals, get the neighborhood involved in developing a process about what they'd like to see happen. And it was agreed upon, and we were able to continue last night's appeal and public hearing for 6 months. And whether my colleague, who's not wild about historic preservation, would have voted one way or the other, I know he appreciated that about 2 hours of public hearings were taken off last night's agenda. So I think that it's an example that, you know, we can all think about things like that when there's a neighborhood conflict. Is there the opportunity to bring people together? Kind of with the specter of going before the council to have the council pick a winner and a loser and to say, you know, why risk a council vote going the way you don't want it to? Try to figure this out. So.
Thanks for bringing that up, Jane. the older I get, the more interested I am in historic preservation. That might have to do with self-preservation, too. You know, this is a dicey balance, and I don't necessarily want to get into all the fine points on that tonight, but I've looked at this, and I've had discussions with my council members and won some and lose some over the years. But my concern is when we're putting in many cases subsidies that can amount to $300,000-$400,000 into a building, and I'm looking around and I can see a lot of houses, if they're in Frogtown, the east side, Rice Street, that if they had $25,000 to put into that house, we could make a major impact on a dozen houses. So it's trying to figure out that balance. I know it's important to save one or two houses for historic value, but on the other hand, money is finite. We just don't have an unlimited pot that we can go to do this kind of stuff. So if we're doing it one place, somewhere else is going to feel the pain of that. So I like to spread it out, and the more I can do to get good housing for our citizens in our town. You know, another thing we used to have years ago is when we got a big investment in some of these buildings for restoration, they could buy, say, just use an example, bought a house for $100,000 that the city had $225,000 in, and they went out and sold that house and got $300,000 for it when the market was sky high. The city didn't receive one dime back of their subsidy that they put into that, and in addition to that, we lost an affordable house. And I'm thinking, how in the world is this working out? How is this fair to all the people that put put their finances up and, you know, paid the taxes to do this. And I heard one really compelling argument, and this was with my tongue in cheek. This woman who was promoting, because we used to have a shared equity thing, and this became or came before the council, and they voted it down, so the shared equity went out of it. The city didn't get any money back. And the woman's argument was, well, listen, I want to buy, we've got a deal on a house in Woodbury, and I want to be able to buy that house and not have any mortgage. She's talking about taking the money that she got and the spread from what she paid for that thing and what she got for it and buying a house in Woodbury, and I'm supposed to feel sorry for it. I'm sorry it doesn't work that way. But those are the kinds of things that we're up against from time to time, and you know, and sometimes I may not come off quite as smooth as I should on that. But I do feel that we have a responsibility to the taxpayers who put up the money in the first place. And if we're going to build and create affordable housing, keep it affordable. I love doing business with Habitat for Humanity because they manage their properties well and they stay affordable.
Okay, I had a request that if you're going to use acronyms, please identify the acronym so that everybody that isn't up on them there. And tonight's forum is going to be broadcast on SPNN, so you can please pass the word and watch for it, and we'll get, I think, a little bit of good publicity out of that. We are working our way towards the end. We have some closing statements time, so I'm going to ask everybody to try and be a little tight if you can on the questions, and I know all the answers are great, so I'm just going to be quiet. With all the focus on attracting and retaining business in St. Paul, conflicts between businesses and neighboring residents get ignored. Why are current nuisance business ordinances not more strictly enforced to make St. Paul increasingly dense and compact and truly livable? And that's maybe a little bit more issue than process, but I think it's a good question.
Is there like a specific?
Nothing specific, just philosophical. Moving towards nuisance businesses and trying in some ways to promote density.
I can only speak on my experience that I think that we have been pretty intolerant of nuisance businesses, especially, you know, working with the neighborhood. One example is there's the you guys remember the salt cellar, right, on Weston and Selby? And so that there was a lot of conflict of interest there. You have business who want salt cellar to be there, and then there's some that don't want. And what I did was, you know, I got together with the community to create a parking task force. And then now we are working to secure more money from PED and the parking fund so that we can do an actual parking study and traffic study to make sure that the decision is not based on one business owner because he or she has more influence than the smaller business. So I think that we do pay attention to that in terms of density. Our city is changing. We are growing. More and more folks want to move into our city. We need to ensure that we have the proper density and also by working with the surrounding neighborhood, especially along the light rail. If we put up density or two or three or four story building there, it's going to impact the neighborhood and it's going to impact the folks right behind that, whether it's the shade or the sun or they don't want to look at a building. And so all of those have to be considered. I can tell you that one of the things that's important to us is senior housing. I want to make sure that we know that in my ward, especially there's a lot of elders who may not have the capacity to maintain their home. Maybe they want to turn that into a rental property and then move to a senior housing where they can have access and resources and they can be around people that understand their who they are. And so then they can get a little bit of income from renting their home. So trying to create those sort of models, making sure that as we work on the soccer stadium, There's going to be a presentation on what kind of housing is going to go there. It's a lot harder to fight for affordable housing if a developer is a private developer. They come in, they don't need your tax dollar, they don't need any subsidy. They're going to build it the way they are, they want. But in my experience, every development that use subsidy from the city, my fellow council member and I, we leverage hard to make sure that there's affordable housing, there's housing for seniors, make sure that if densities are appropriate. But if there's things that we need to improve on, we love to hear from you and to work on that as well.
The density issue is always something that it depends on where you're coming from, I guess. If you happen to live in a neighborhood of single family homes on 40 foot or 50 foot lots, that's probably dense enough for you. One of the things that's happened in a lot in Frogtown, a lot on the east side, is a lot of those homes were duplexes, and well, they still are, as a matter of fact. But back in the 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, most all of those were owner-occupied homes. And what happened when the market started changing here 20, 25 years ago, a lot of those folks were moving on somewhere else, and the kids, the younger people coming up, it wasn't cool to have a duplex anymore. The duplex, actually, I lived in one for years and years and years and owned it. It's the most inexpensive housing you can possibly get because you got a tenant upstairs. If you rent the place to the right price, they aren't going to tear it up. And it's a good way to make the house payments. But nobody wanted to really get involved in that. So as a result, the folks moved out and the properties became rental. And you take a look, when we get appeals on these things today, where the ownership is coming from. Very little of it. The ownership is coming from the city of St. Paul. These people are all over the place, and some of them even out of state. And that, in my opinion, is something that's really hurt. One of the greatest things we could do in this town is figure out a way to get ownership back in those duplexes and to get owners to occupy those things. And for young people to recognize that is the most affordable housing you're ever going to be able to find. And just to reestablish those neighborhoods, and I think a lot of you that have been around for a while know the streets that I'm talking about where the duplexes were on there. You could never tell that it was a rental property because those people took care of those properties. So it's a chance to get back to that particular home ownership.
Good evening. My name is Yusuf M. Janey, and I want to echo something that Councilmember Bostrom just said. If you look at this neighborhood, Summit University, the immediately adjacent neighborhood, Thomas Dale, also known as Frogtown, and the North End, it constitutes the largest racially concentrated area of poverty in the metropolitan area. One out of every four houses in this racially concentrated area of poverty is subsidized. Do you know what the ratio is for the city of St. Paul? It's 1 out of 50. And people in low-income neighborhoods ought not only find out about new concentrations of lower-income people being stacked on top of other low-income existing residents in the newspaper or on the news. There needs to be more discussion, more opportunity for input and for equity. And I want to tell you why. If I can take a second, I want to advocate for white people in the suburbs. When Grandpa Johnson dies and leaves Grandma Johnson on the homestead or the farmstead, or when Grandma Johnson's daughter's husband runs off with the waitress from the country western restaurant and leaves her with three kids and hockey practice and, you know, medical insurance and everything else, why should they have to come to Summit University, to Thomas Dale, to the Lower East Side, or the North End in order to find safe, energy-efficient, affordable housing? We need life cycle housing. That's for newlyweds, for single moms with dependent children who need multi-bedroom facilities, for non-elderly, childless adults. We need home ownership. Affordable housing doesn't have to mean just low-income, very low-income, rental, subsidized housing. We do need, the largest welfare program in the country is the home mortgage tax deduction. We need programs that promote and support homeownership, homeownership training programs. And we need them throughout the community because it is an indictment against the future of any community if they become where 85% of the affordable low-income rental housing in the city is located. And I think that has an impact on the quality of life for the total city. So hopefully we can encourage and spur discussions about siting and location and options and alternatives throughout the city of St. Paul and not just in neighborhoods, because segregated housing leads to segregated schools, which leads to the school-to-prison pipeline, to the largest achievement gap in the country. And there needs to be more communication between the city, the school district, HUD, the HRA, and all of the other players so that we have truly a level playing field in terms of access, options, alternatives, transportation, and life choices. Thank you.
I'd like to just sort of dovetail on to that. It's Linda Windsor again. And I'm also on Save Our St. Paul Neighborhoods that Jane had referred to. And there's another thing about affordable housing throughout our city, too. It's called little 1920s bungalows that are under attack in Wards 3 and Ward 4. And so the process is what I want to relate to, that we don't have a process of public information about a demo request. So until the demo permit has been issued. And that's a process issue in St. Paul, because if you want to look at maintaining the housing stock that we have and or improving it, it's a problem when you have, I'm going to say, a lot of out of the city developers coming in, tearing down these homes and building, some people call them McMansions, I call them big shoeboxes, that will not stand the time of quality work and have many problems, and also change the character of the neighborhoods. And for seniors and young families and other people who need those smaller homes, things are being changed, and we don't really have any input into it. It's all about money right now at the city, and I would really like city council members to be able to address that, because we are a citywide organization raising these issues, and it's really important that we have some public input before things are destroyed in our neighborhoods.
Jane Prince just passed me a note and said, can I say something about TIF and economic development planning? I'm probably the city's biggest headache when it comes to TIF. Tax increment financing. We have reached our limits on tax increment financing, and frankly, we probably reached our limit 20 years ago. We continue to do it, and every time a TIF project is developed, it's taken off the tax rolls. So here we are with about 33% of our city that doesn't pay taxes because they're nonprofits, schools, government. And on top of that, we have now taken a large portion of our most developable properties and taken them off the tax rolls. And so when we try to put parking meters on Grand Avenue to raise $400,000, we're giving $26 million away every year to developers. That's why we're in this hole we're in. And now we find that people feel that we have to continue to give TIF or we'll never have a developer come to St. Paul. Minneapolis learned that lesson a number of years ago, has had 10 times as much development in the last 5 years as St. Paul has. St. Paul has given out $114 million in TIF and Minneapolis $24 million. So what we've done is taken the easy route and not looking at the long run. So that's what I can tell you about TIF. I could tell you about another 2 hours worth, but we can.
A couple of points while we're figuring out where we're going to go next, and we can come back to TIF. But one of the questions from the audience, and then I've been reminded that It is also okay for the city council to ask the St. Paul Strong Steering Committee questions as to what you think we are, maybe good, bad, or indifferent, but you've come here and we should be willing to answer our questions. And this is in that line, and anybody can answer. Where was or where is the disconnect in the processes in the St. Paul city government that led to people feeling like there was a need for St. Paul Strong?
Well, there's been, there's a small group of us got together a year and a half ago to talk about the fact that things that were happening at the city council and in the mayor's office that we had no input. There were, I think there's a list of 26 what we call grievances on our website of issues. Now, by the way, again, St. Paul Strong is not only the steering committee, there's more people, but we are on all sides of the issues. One thing that we all agree on is that there hasn't been a fair public process. There's something on called consent agenda, where issues come to the city council. If the city council agrees that they don't want to have any discussion, it goes on the consent agenda, and there is no public input into it. Comcast, I think it was a 10-year contract, went through without any public input, and there's been a lot of unhappiness about it. And we wonder, why isn't there that opportunity to go to the city and talk about it? And see, you know, it's not that we would change decisions at the city council, but we just feel that if the public had a chance to have input, we could improve that decision. There's a lot of opportunities to make things better. We don't have to throw something away or ideas away. It's just there's a whole lot of people in this city who have a lot of experience that are frozen out of the system. And that's the reason that we are here. So hopefully we can do that. Linda?
And I'd like to say, I'd like to compliment, you know, what Councilmember Dietau was saying, and Jane Princeton, probably Dan, if I missed it. You know, you're looking for ways for input, and you talk about working with the groups and getting the feedback and all of that. Well, one of the things that happens at process at the city is when a major decision has been made primarily behind closed doors and gets approved, and then the public hears about it, and then they set up a community or a citizens advisory committee, but you have to apply for that committee and be appointed by the mayor. So, for example, the stadium issue that was decided, I mean, pretty much without a lot of public input, from my impression, whether or not you agree with it or not, it did. There was not information and chances to do it. So now, if you want to help with some of the things that relate to development on there with that area, you can, well, they've already chosen the community advisory committee, but they all had to be appointed by the mayor. So what does that say about, and probably there's a diversity of opinion there, but it seems like that process should be changed, and maybe it could be brought back towards council members helping put people on those committees so that it's more independent and they're more in touch with their neighbors and people who might bring the expertise and the representation from their neighborhoods than I believe probably the mayor who's at the top. So I wonder how you feel about that.
I'm going to go to Rick first.
Rick Cardenas. And again, it's the St. Paul Strong came out of the frustration of a number of things. And this may get into a little bit of an issue, but the converting of so many public lands to private contractors, the golf course, you know, and what are the contracts that the city is getting into? And I know another example, of course, is Black Bear Crossing, a signed contract for X amount of years that just puffs up goes in smoke. You know, and the privatization. Where are the public hearings on these, on the privatization of golf courses, playgrounds, and other things? So, I tend to be more on the Bernie Sanders side, and I don't know about this private-public kind of stuff. I want more public sort of things that we can all get into and know the money is not going to United Help. So.
Yusuf Mjani again, the old curmudgeon. Did anyone take the green line to tonight's meeting? If the NAACP had not filed a lawsuit, you would have had to get off at Dale or at Rice Street to come here tonight to create three additional stops in low-income neighborhoods between Western and Hamlin and Victoria. And there clearly ought to be opportunities up front for greater public input in the discussion, especially when tax dollars are being spent for the benefit of the community. So again, if people only find out about something when it parachutes into their community, or they accidentally hear it in the laundromat or from a neighbor, or read about it in the paper, and the deal has already been done, it doesn't make people feel very engaged in the public dialogue or the public policy process. And I said at the very beginning, the biggest room in the world is room for improvement. We simply want to implore our elected officials to improve the mechanisms and the process, the communication, the timing, and the opportunity. St. Paul Strong has never requested exclusive access or sole input. We just want the process opened up so that whoever is so inclined has the opportunity to put their two cents in, to make suggestions, to offer constructive criticisms. And we at St. Paul Strong believe the constructive criticisms that we've raised have three components. First, you have to specifically state what's wrong and why it's ugly. Two, you have to provide options and alternatives. You can't just say it's wrong, don't do it. Okay. Three, you have to say what you're willing to do to help. And that's one of the reasons why we're holding the forum this evening, because we said it's not simply about us meeting in a coffee shop and crying in the latte, but we really ought to, you know, broaden this discussion and invite other members of the public, so that when they feel elective decisions are in the process of being made, that they make sure to raise their voice so that it is a part of the process, because it can only result in a better, you know, product for everybody. The end product is what we're interested in, not taking the credit or getting our pictures in the paper or having somebody slap us on the back, but having a better democratic process. So we would like to help. We would like to see that happen, and we think it has not always been in the best interest of the elected officials. And we've seen significant change on the Board of Education for what many people believe is that exact reason, that they were not in touch with parents and families and staff and students. And I think that there's a, you know, I watched this, forgive me, a personal issue, this clown car circus, you know, on MSNBC and CNN every night, the presidential campaigns. And there's a tremendous amount of public disaffection out there, you know, in terms of the political process. And it's kind of sad when people look at Congress and elected officials and, you know, they're single digit in terms of public approval ratings. And I just think we have a responsibility to push the system and implore that we do whatever possible to raise that so that it is more reflective of a participatory democracy. So.
Councilmember Tao?
I just have a question for the St. Paul Strong. You know, what are your, where's your position on racial equity in the city of St. Paul? For example, in my experience there, I see that the city of St. Paul is about 40% people of color, but the workforce is about 80% white. Now, I'm not saying I don't want white people to have jobs. I do. But if we truly believe in the core value of our country that's founded on government is for the people by the people, then our workforce has to be representative of the constituents. Otherwise, decisions are going to be made in a vacuum. We can have the best policy in the world, But if we have practices and behavior that does not reflect the outcome that we want, we'll never see change. And so I want to hear how St. Paul Strong feel about that. Is that something they want to work on? If we can take care of the racial equity issue, we're going to solve a bunch of other issue that's connected, because all the issues are connected, from housing to job disparity to police brutality. And lastly, where does St. Paul Strong stand on body cam and ensuring that our police officer, I know all of them are, not all of them are bad, right? And so we have a really good force, but you know, we all people in St. Paul need to be treated with dignity and due process by our law enforcement. So where do you guys stand, and how are you gonna work with the city council and our other activists to make sure that there's racial equity and all the things that I mentioned?
Council Member Tao, Yusuf Mjani, St. Paul Strong has not taken a policy position on those issues, body cameras or racial equity. What we have taken a position on is the question of who are the intended beneficiaries and how are they included in the process of contributing to the public policy decisions that are being made. So if it's an issue that affects senior citizens, we believe strongly that they ought to be at the table. If it's an issue that affects women, if it affects people of color, if it affects renters, if it affects the residents of public housing projects, then if they are the intended beneficiaries, then we're not going to produce or contribute to very effective policies in their absence. So if you read our principles, you'll notice that inclusion is deeply embedded in them, okay? That the people who are affected by the policies, we saw that this week in terms of the preservation issues in Dayton's Bluff. The people in Dayton's Bluff need to be at the table and have some input into what the ultimate outcome is for those houses that were purchased 10, 12 years ago at considerable taxpayer expense and then allowed to be run down to the point where now the recommendation is that they be completely destroyed. So we are for inclusion, whether that is in the workforce, in the public policy process, in the housing market, in public safety, or in education. And we think that that's, you know, I travel a lot. The challenges and opportunities that we face in St. Paul are so much more manageable than they are in Chicago or Detroit or East St. Louis or many of the other comparable areas around the country. So when people ask me where I'm from, I don't want to have to say I'm from the Midwest, okay? I know Jesse Ventura is no longer the governor, but then they say, oh, really? I have family up there. Specifically, where are you from? I don't want to have to say the upper Midwest. I want to be able to say I'm from the capital city of the great state of Minnesota, St. Paul, and tell them why I'm proud to be here, why I'm active here, why I'm civically engaged here. I don't want to have to tell them that we have the highest achievement gap in the United States. I don't want to have to tell them that the home ownership rates for African Americans are lower in Minnesota today than they were in Mississippi in the 1940s. I don't want to have to tell them that at one point, we black males here earned the highest percentage of their white male counterparts in the workforce in the United States, and now we're down to number 50 in terms of where we're at across the country. I mean, when you look at all the negative social indicators, why do we have to be at the head of the line for the entire country, sending more young black and white and brown and red and yellow women and men to the correctional system than to higher education? You know, I mean, it's crazy. It's absolutely crazy. And I think we not only have a duty and a responsibility, but an opportunity to do something about it. And that begins in the public policy process. Excuse me.
You know,
but we didn't take a position on any of these issues.
Roy, could I, David Glass have a chance to answer? He's probably, you should be heard on that.
David Glass, I'm a member of the White Earth Band of Ojibwe in northwestern Minnesota. I'm one of the guys who met in the coffee shop initially when St. Paul Strong was forming. And one of the core principles, Di, and this is for your question, to answer your question, was that with the folks that I was meeting with, one of the things that I consistently said was this: we won't have a strong group of people here that can address issues for St. Paul to St. Paul, unless it reflects the diversity of our great city. And at the table, we need to have our immigrant communities, we need to have Native Americans, we need to have Hmong, Vietnamese, the Pan Asian, the Hispanic Latino. We need to have everyone represented. And so we worked hard from the very beginning to bring that group of people. And if you look around here tonight, you'll see that, you know, of the 10 or 11 people that we have on the executive committee, five of us are folks of color, minority communities. And it's our intent, and we agree with you, that the color, you know, that the city of St. Paul should reflect that throughout the administration, throughout the workforce, and throughout the businesses.
No, go ahead. Okay. We're going to end up with giving each of the council members 2 minutes for closing statements, so we've got probably one longer question and then a shorter one. And anybody can work into this.